When I took this job as head of ranch security, I knew that I was only flesh and blood, four legs, a tail, a couple of ears, a pretty nice kind of nose that the women really go for, two bushels of hair, and another half bushel of Mexican sand burrs. You add all that up and you don't get Superman, just me. Good old easygoing Hank, who works hard, tries to do his job, and gets very little cooperation from anyone else around here. It's me again, the hero of tomorrow, and welcome to episode 4 of the We Are Here podcast. Well, I say that, but I'm under no illusion that people are going to watch or listen to this episode in particular. Back when I used to do Art of Gaming episodes, those were usually about obscure but good games that nobody played. And because nobody had played them, hardly anyone watched the episodes. Granted, I don't get a lot of views to begin with, but those got even less. So imagine how few people are going to watch a video about not only a relatively obscure series, albeit one that means a lot to me, but a video about a series of books. Of all the people that review media on YouTube, the people who review books seem to get even less attention than the people who review movies or TV. I'm not slighting them in any way, quite the opposite in fact. Because Booktubers have to do possibly the most work out of all reviewers. Videos are, well, a visual medium, and unless you're reviewing a book that's lavishly illustrated, you're gonna find very few visuals. So often, you either have to draw your own, or use Photoshop and Google Images or some other means to fabricate visuals to go with what you're talking about. This isn't an easy task, especially since the people who review movies or TV already have ready-made visuals to accompany their points. So in my opinion, Booktubers are some of the most creative video makers out there that get the least amount of attention. I can think of at least three that do deserve it. Bookworm Reviews, The Literary Lair, and The Hungry Reader. There's also Pop Arena, although Pop Arena does a variety of videos and the Knickknacks retrospective he's currently doing is bringing in a lot more subscribers for him, so chances are you don't need a small-time YouTuber like me to tell you about his work. But you should check it out anyway. I bring all this up because I wouldn't normally talk about books on my channel because that's not what my reviews are usually for. But since I now have this podcast where I can occasionally step outside the realm of what my reviews can normally do, I'm going to use it to talk about a book series that I'm sure almost none of you have read, but that means a lot to me. Today we'll be talking about Hank the Cowdog. Hank the Cowdog is a series of children's books written by John R. Erickson and illustrated by Gerald L. Holmes. Erickson has a lot of experience as a Texan rancher, which he drew on for the books. The books take place on a ranch, we never learn the ranch's actual name, run by a cowboy named Hi Loper, who lives there with his wife, Sally Mae, their son Little Alfred, and their ranch hand Slim Chance. But this is not their story. This is the story of their guard dog, Hank, and his experiences as the self-styled head of ranch security. Yes, this story is mostly told from Hank's point of view, meaning that this is yet another talking animal story that was a big part of my formative years. Apparently, Hank was based on a real-life Australian Shepherd dog that Erickson owned. Like a lot of dogs, Hank thinks that he's a bigger deal than he actually is. I say that as someone who loves dogs, but if you've ever seen a Chihuahua trying to bark at an intruder, you know what I'm talking about. And since Hank is basically the sheriff of this ranch, at least according to him, he thinks he's Andy Taylor when he's really Paul Blart, which is an insult to Hank, but it's also kind of true. He thinks he's the strong protector of the ranch when really, except on occasion where he actually does show great competence, his exploits usually involve him solving the case through sheer dumb luck. Yeah, every book is usually the case of something or other, and are mostly self-contained stories, though most of the character relationships do extend over the various books. I say characters because, of course, Hank isn't the only talking animal in this series. There's his sidekick, Drover, a smaller white mutt who's not as smart as Hank, but is cowardly enough to know when there's danger afoot and how to avoid it, usually faking an injured leg, usually making Hank the one to rush into danger, often over his head. But there are some books where he's shown to be a bit smarter in other areas, and on some occasions he's taken over as head of ranch security when Hank wasn't available. There's actually a book called Drover's Secret Life that's told from his perspective, but I haven't read it yet. Outside of that, we know almost nothing about him except that he had a family at one point but ended up on the ranch. There's Pete the Barn Cat who, Well, since the book is narrated by a dog, you can probably guess what he thinks of him. He's portrayed as a mooch, a manipulator, especially of Sally Mae, and in general, he's very slimy. But in books like The Case of the Missing Cat, it's pretty well established that Hank needs him at the ranch, and Pete knows that he does, even though Hank would never admit it. Plus, in theory, he does keep the mouse population down, though we never see him do it. We don't get much time with the other animals on the ranch aside from the rooster J.T. Cluck, who fancies himself commander of the henhouse in the same way Hank is head of ranch security, except he makes Hank look like a genius, as you'd expect from a chicken. I've already mentioned the human character, so let's go over them next. Loper is the one we see the least of. He's just a somewhat strict ranch owner who also happens to be a dad, and he fills that role pretty well. Sally Mae is a hard ass, and someone that Hank fears due to how often she gets angry at him. In some cases because Pete manipulates her into doing it, and sometimes because he's in the wrong place at the wrong time. But she's also a caring mother, and if her son is in danger, woe betide the person or creature who gets in her way. And she really does care for Hank deep down, which shows in books like The Case of the Double Bumblebee Sting, where she's pretty much taking care of the snake-bitten Hank throughout the latter half of the book. Little Alfred is your typical little boy. He likes to go on adventures, has that precious little speech impediment where he pronounces R's as W's, and most importantly, he's one of the few humans who can understand the animals talking with each other because... childhood innocence? I'll buy it. Slim lives in a separate house down the creek, and probably for the best. It's not that he's a bad guy or anything, but he is a bachelor, so he kinda lets the place go to seed. Hey, it's not like he has to impress anyone when he's not working. Well, unless he's trying to clean up for his not-girlfriend, Miss Viola. The dogs, of course, relate to him the most, for obvious reasons. Moving outside of the ranch, we have the recurring villains, the coyotes. They're portrayed here as shaggy, rough, disgusting approximations of dogs, much like they are in real life. Mostly they're represented by the recurring duo, Rip and Snort, who speak in broken English and love to, well, do what their name suggests. Oh, and there's also one of Hank's two or three love interests, a sweeter coyote girl with the oh-so-nice name of Girl Who Drink Blood. Hank just calls her Missy Coyote most of the time, and she seems to be fine with that. She has a brother named Scrunch that's kind of the leader of the pack, but we almost never see him. Often when Hank runs into the coyotes, it's because they're causing damage on the ranch. Sometimes, though, it's when he's considering quitting his job and going to live in the wild, only to find it's a little too wild for a domestic dog like him and heading back to the ranch. Apparently, he and Missy are betrothed or something, but it doesn't come up a lot. The books are thankfully pretty G-rated, only occasionally skirting into PG territory when something violent or disgusting happens. Speaking of disgusting, there are also two buzzards that are recurring characters, the grumpy old man Wallace and his nicer son with the pronounced stutter, Junior. And it's from this book series that I first learned that the natural defense mechanism of a buzzard is to throw up on whatever's threatening them. And given that buzzards eat carrion, you can imagine how disgusting that would be. Outside of them, there are characters that show up less often. Since Hank can't really drive, he's pretty much stuck on the ranch unless he hitches a ride on Slim's truck. There's Buster and Muggs and their gang of town thugs, who occasionally cause trouble for Hank, but since they live in town, it's not often, much like Hank's sort of friend, Ralph the Basset Hound. There's Hank's main love interest, Miss Beulah the Collie. Well, she's the one he's most interested in. After the first book she appeared in or so, it's pretty clear that she's more interested in another dog named Plato, a bird dog that her family keeps. Hank doesn't like him, but it's not really a love triangle situation because Plato is completely oblivious to Hank's feelings. And for that reason, you really can't dislike the guy. And then there are characters that appear even less often, like Eddie the Rack, the scheming little raccoon that the ranch family briefly adopted. Every stereotype about raccoons that you've heard, he basically fulfills them. He's a schemer, a con artist, and can do amazing things that most animals can't with those little hands he's got, which impresses Hank even when he's locking him inside his own cage. There's Miss Scamper, who's basically the canine G-rated equivalent of a vamp character, who's good at manipulating dogs like Hank. And then there's probably the weirdest character, Madam Moonshine. She pretty much shows up whenever Erickson wants an excuse to write a book with supernatural elements because she's outright stated to have magical powers. She's sort of a witch of an owl, but she's definitely one of the more flighty, half-crazed fictional witches. Very Witch Hazel, honestly. So as a result, her powers don't always work the way she wants them to. I think she doesn't appear that often because usually the conflicts the story focuses on are a bit more grounded in reality, whether it's an antagonist causing trouble on the ranch, interpersonal drama with the characters, or a trip to some new location. She appears less and less often as the books continue, but I think that just makes the time she does appear that much more fun. Like I said, every book is pretty much a self-contained story, and that can range from dealing with a cattle rustler to stopping a wild horse that's wreaking havoc on the ranch. And the tone can range from interpersonal drama to screwball comedy, often within the same book. If I ever get the time, maybe I'll do a Hank the Cowdog opinionated book guide or something, but I doubt I'll ever have that kind of time. The books are kind of short. At about 12 chapters each, the books only run for about 100 pages, about the length of your average Goosebumps book. That said, there are a few standout entries that I'll talk about in brief. In The Curse of the Incredible Priceless Corn Cob, every animal on the ranch becomes obsessed with this old corn cob, treating it as though it were some kind of priceless treasure. And it's played surprisingly straight. The characters end up fighting over something that most humans would call worthless. Of course, this is a classic technique that's been made famous by the likes of Chuck Jones. By humanizing animals, it becomes easier to see the animal's traits in ourselves. In the case of the swirling killer tornado, the ranch has to deal with an incoming tornado, and the buildup for the storm arriving is phenomenally tense. I live in Tornado Alley, and I've been through several tornadoes, though thankfully none of them have hit anywhere close to me. And I've never been as afraid of a tornado in real life as I was when I was a kid reading this book. Granted, it becomes a bit goofier when our heroes end up getting swept up in it and survive, Wizard of Oz style, but hey, the books wouldn't have killed them off anyway. In Slim's Goodbye, Slim packs up and leaves the ranch when he learns that they're going through a recession, believing that Loper can't afford to pay him but is too nice to fire him. He gets to come back in the end, but for a while we actually get to see Slim's uncertainty as he has to deal with the very real possibility that he might never see his home again. It's surprisingly somber for this series. But the book that stuck with me the most as a kid was The Case of the Halloween Ghost. Even if it's a bit silly in retrospect. For the whole book, thanks to Pete, Hank ends up convinced that there's a ghost around the ranch and its own paranoia that he ends up dealing with. Until the very end of the book when it's revealed that there was a real ghost the whole time. Now, the ghost doesn't do anything too scary. It's just an old preacher that shows up and sings a hymn. But of course, if you're a kid, or Hank or Drover, and aren't expecting it, well, it'd scare you too. Between this and Garfield's Halloween Adventure, it's one of the few times where the suddenly supernatural ending twist actually works. So, why pick this series to talk about, other than nostalgia? Well, there are a few reasons. For one, like I said, I grew up with this series. They're simple books to read, only about a fourth grade reading level, so they were some of the first books I really got into. I would read them aloud to my family at night, and occasionally I'd even give the characters voices. I'm not gonna say that it's the reason I was inspired to start making videos in the first place, but hey, I know how causality works, and it definitely got me started on that path. In fact, doing audiobooks is something I want to do professionally one of these days. And if I can be candid with you for a bit, that memory is also tied to a childhood memory that's not so sweet. One of the members of my family that I read to was my grandfather on my dad's side. Now, even when I first knew my grandpa, he was pretty old and frail. But he did enjoy it when I read to him, and it made him laugh on occasion. And I'm nothing if not a performer, so I gladly did it for him. And one memory that still sticks with me is that the night before he died, I was reading him a Hank the Cowdog book. I even remember which one it was. The Case of the Fiddle-Playing Fox. I wasn't that close to him, but it still kills me inside that I could never finish that book for him. And on that awkward note, let's move on to the second reason. Because I was hit with some new inspiration to do a video on this series fairly recently. I live in Arkansas, which is where I grew up, but I don't live in my hometown. It's about 2 hours away from where I live now, but every so often I'd drive back there. And the last time I did, I decided to drop in at my old library, which is where I originally discovered Hank the Cowdog. I actually went to the library so often as a kid that my family became friends with one of the librarians. Yeah, I know, I was that much of a dork. So I was there to say hi to her, but I took the time to peruse those old YA fiction shelves, and I got the shock of my life when I saw that the series of books I grew up with was still running. Yeah, looking back now, it's not that surprising, considering that I would have read this around 2000 to 2003, but Hank had already been running since before I was born, starting in 1982. But since then, it's kind of exploded. At one point, there was a fan newsletter called the Hank Times that you could subscribe to, and you'd better believe that I was for a while. But since then, this series, which had only reached about 50 books when I last checked, has put out 72 of them, with a 73rd coming in spring of 2019. And technically, there's even more than that. All of the books are available in audiobook form, with the first 49 even available on cassette, with Erickson himself narrating. I kind of want to get these because every book has about two songs in it, which I never got to hear just reading the books. And there are some books that are only available through audio, like The Case of the Dancing Cowboy, which you'd only know about if you had a subscription to the Hank Times. I still need to get those someday. When I last tried to look up info on Hank the Cowdog, it didn't even have a Wikipedia page. Now it does. There's an official blog where you can keep up with news of the series, and it's there that I found out that there have been multiple attempts to make cartoons out of Hank. In 1985, CBS Storybreak aired an animated version of the first Hank the Cowdog book, The Original Adventures. It's okay, even if it made a lot of changes to the setting, like the location being on a chicken farm in Arizona. Come on, Hank is distinctly a Texas-based story, guys. And in 2015, the LA-based HTC Productions announced that they would be working with the New Zealand animation studio Hoohoo Productions to make a new animated series based on the books. That didn't quite pan out, but the pilot is available for viewing. It's not great. The animation isn't quite up to snuff, even for this show. But I would gladly take that over the previous attempt in the late 90s. Supposedly, this would have been produced by Nickelodeon, Wildbrain, and 501 Productions, blending 2D animation with live-action backgrounds, and folks, I'm not gonna lie to you, this looks horrible. The humans look okay, but Hank is terrifying. He's close to how Hank looks in the Gerald L. Holmes illustrations, but his expressions just don't look right. That is not the face of a happy dog. That is the face of a dog doll in pain. But regardless of how badly those attempts turned out, I'm honestly kind of glad that a book series from my childhood is still running. And from what I can tell, it's still going strong. It still consistently makes Laura Bush's summer reading list for kids, and honestly, good for them. The books are harmless, very child-friendly, and still pretty funny as far as I can tell. It hasn't really completely sold out and become soulless like Garfield. There's still plenty of heart to be found in Hank the Cowdog. Some of them might even teach you things. More recently, Erickson has started to use the characters as sort of teaching assistants to help kids learn about ranch life in a few side books. And ultimately, it resonates with a deep-seated part of me that I can't really deny. I grew up in a rural area, and Hank the Cowdog has that same down-home country charm that does. But in a way that doesn't make me question why I ever found it funny after I grew up and became more socially conscious. I'll admit that there is still a third of the series that I've never read, but if it can last for almost 40 years, I think they must be doing something right. I'm the hero of tomorrow, and I'll see you down the road on the next edition of the We Are Here podcast. Life ain't nothing but a funny, funny riddle.